Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2021. This morning we'll be taking evidence on Scotland's strategic framework from John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Dominic Munro, Director for COVID-19 Exit Strategy, and Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director from the Scottish Government. I would like to welcome our witnesses to the meeting who are joining us remotely. Deputy First Minister, could I please invite you to make a brief opening statement?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I welcome this opportunity to appear before the committee for the first time since my appointment as Portfolio Minister for COVID Recovery. This is a vital part of the process of parliamentary accountability, which will undoubtedly strengthen our approach to recovery. I will, of course, be happy to respond to any line of inquiry the committee wishes to do today. However, I'd like to take some time to firstly set out our developing approach to COVID recovery, then turn to the First Minister's recent announcement about the public inquiry, the current public consultation on COVID recovery legislation, and finally to update the committee on our ongoing activity to respond to the pandemic, which unfortunately is still very much with us. In reappointing me as Deputy First Minister, the First Minister also asked me to lead the cross-government and cross-parliament work necessary to guide the country through the pandemic and into a recovery that supports the National Health Service, protects and creates jobs, supports our young people and contributes to Scotland's ambition to be a net zero nation. Moreover, I'm determined that our approach to recovery should take us closer to the kind of Scotland we all want to see, a country that is more equal and addresses the inequalities exacerbated by the pandemic. A country where the economy is guiding us towards a more sustainable future with good green jobs and fair work for all. A country with public services supported to recover from the pandemic, but also to putting person-centred design and delivery at the heart. In the last 100 days, we've seen a real cross-government effort to support key actions covering COVID recovery. The safe and effective remobilisation of the National Health Service is one of our top priorities, and on the 25th of August, we published our National Recovery Plan. This sets out key commitments that will support recovery over the next 5 years, supported by the implementation of sustainable improvements and new models of care. I recognise that achieving our ambition for recovery will require more than the efforts of national government. Wider collaboration and partnership is essential. To that end, I've used part of the summer to engage with a wide range of stakeholders across the private, public and third sectors on the priorities they see for COVID recovery. Just over 60 organisations have in fact been involved in this exercise, and I've met regularly with the presidential team from the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, recognising the crucial role which local government has played throughout our response to the pandemic, from assisting the rollout of walk-in test centres to delivering self-isolation support and business grants. Our local authorities have provided vital support to individuals, organisations and businesses through close partnership with the Scottish Government. I'm determined to do all that I can to support this close partnership working as an essential element to our approach to recovery. I know that it's only by harnessing the collective work of both democratic spheres of government and involving as many of our partners as possible that we'll be able to achieve the recovery that we want to see. I intend to set out in more detail the partnership that we will take forward with local government when the COVID recovery strategy is published in due course. Members will be interested, I'm sure, in how we intend to take forward the establishment of a public inquiry into the COVID response. The Scottish Government has always been committed to the establishment of a public inquiry into the pandemic, and it will be established by the end of this year, as was promised. We've published draft aims and principles for the inquiry, which, following consultation between now and the end of September with interested parties, including bereaved families, will become the formal terms of reference. Anybody who wants to can and should contribute to this consultation process. The inquiry will look at all matters related to the handling of the pandemic that were within our devolved competence. This will include, of course, the situation in care homes. The consultation will close on the 30th of September, and the Lord Advocate has begun discussions with the Lord President about appointing a member of the judiciary to head the inquiry. It is worth stressing that we will cooperate closely with other governments, including the United Kingdom government, on their inquiries into COVID. Apart from anything else, we recognise that by doing that, we might lessen the burden on organisations and individuals who who are making submissions to our inquiry. That will, of course, include people who have lost loved ones to COVID. But that need for discussion and cooperation can't be a reason for delay. I believe that an inquiry into the handling of COVID in Scotland potentially has a very important role to play, both in scrutinising the decisions that have been made in the past and in highlighting lessons for the future. I therefore believe that it is appropriate to establish that inquiry as soon as possible. The consultation that we have launched is an important early step towards doing that. In addition to progressing the establishment of the inquiry, we've also taken early steps to consult on how we recover from this crisis and ensure that we are prepared for any future ones, reflecting on the lessons we have all learned over the last 18 months. As part of this, we must ensure that we review the impact of COVID on the Scottish statute book and carefully consider any benefits of legislative reforms that may be worth retaining. Our 12-week consultation has been published widely, and members of the public are already contributing their views. The consultation invites views on 30 specific legislative proposals that have the potential to support COVID recovery, such as greater public health resilience to protect against future threats, and the possible retention of improvements and modernisations to public services and to the justice system. The consultation paper outlines our ambitions for COVID recovery and ends with an open question inviting comments on the actions that respondents think it is required to support a fair, safe and secure recovery. During the pandemic, the power to make public health regulations has been instrumental to manage the public health threat through a range of different measures at each point based on expert advice. The public health regulations proposal is not intended to make lockdown measures permanent, but is rather designed to ensure Scotland continues to have the ability to respond proportionately and appropriately to a whole variety of public health threats. A successful recovery will be unfeasible if we do not effectively respond to the immediate risks that the virus continues to pose. An effective and sustainable response to the pandemic will lay the foundation for the sort of recovery that we want to see. The First Minister set out yesterday we have a steady and ongoing increase in cases that has caused us real concern. However, it is important to note that vaccination is significantly weakening the link between high numbers of cases and serious harm to people's health. That is why the Scottish Government's aim in controlling COVID at this stage in the pandemic is different from previous stages. We are no longer seeking to suppress COVID to the lowest possible level. Now that we have vaccinations, the restrictions required to suppress COVID could not be justified, given that those restrictions cause serious harms of their own. Instead, we are seeking to suppress the virus in a way which alleviates its harms, but which allows us to recover and rebuild for the future. We need children to go to school, businesses to operate more normally, and all of us to be able to socialise and live more freely. That is why so many restrictions, except for key baseline measures, were lifted on the 9th of August. And it is why, in many ways, we should not be too surprised by the recent rise in case numbers. But we cannot be relaxed about these figures either. The link between new cases and serious health harms has been weakened, but it has not been broken. And so the surge we have seen may well result in more people going to hospital and, sadly, more people losing their lives. That is why the Scottish Government is engaging with businesses and organisations in different sectors of the economy to enhance compliance with existing regulations and to maximise the impact of baseline measures. It is vital that all of us follow the baseline measures that do remain in place. For example, we are asking people to continue to wear face coverings in indoor public places. This is a reasonably simple and straightforward way which we can protect each other and reduce the risk of transmission. We are also asking people to be mindful of the basic steps we should continue to take, for example, washing hands and surfaces, and even though it's not the law anymore, to keep a safe distance from people in other households if you can. The final step that we will take to help to protect individuals and the country as a whole in the short term and to reduce the risk of further restrictions being necessary is to propose the introduction of vaccine certification to be introduced later this month in certain limited settings, subject to parliamentary debate and a vote to signify approval. To conclude, Convener, the Scottish Government welcomes the establishment of the COVID Recovery Committee, which I know will play a crucial role in leading the country through the ongoing pandemic and into a fair and just recovery. I welcome any questions the committee may have, and I'm grateful for the opportunity to be able to make an extensive statement to open the proceedings of the committee in this session.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I'll now turn to questions. I would remind members that we have approximately 6 minutes each for questions. It would be helpful if we could keep our questions and answers concise. If there is time for supplementaries, I will indicate this once all members have had a chance to ask questions. If I may begin by asking the first question, which you just touched on, Deputy First Minister. The Scottish Government committed to the establishment of a cross-party steering group on COVID recovery, which met before the summer. Could you explain what role you see this steering group playing moving forward and how that will differ from the role of this committee?
I think the cross-party group and this committee have two very distinct roles. I see this committee in fulfilling the role of parliamentary accountability that is absolutely the heart of the operations of Parliament. And this committee must be free to explore and to examine any question it considers to be appropriate in relation to COVID recovery. The cross-party group that we established before the summer recess, and which met on a number of occasions before summer recess and will resume its meeting pattern next week, is designed to try to create a more informal sounding board where we can draw together parliamentary opinion on the difficult questions with which we still wrestle. We have a number of those questions in the handling of the pandemic, and I think by the current pattern of rising numbers of cases, that challenge remains obvious for members of Parliament for the foreseeable future. So we view the role of the cross-party group to be an opportunity to try to bring together parliamentary opinion to address some of the difficult challenges that we have to face.
Thank you. I'd like to ask Mr. Fraser, would you like to ask a question?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. I'm sure I'm not the only MSP either in this committee or across the Parliament who has had overnight a large number of concerns raised by constituents about the announcement yesterday from the Scottish Government on the introduction of vaccine passports or vaccine certification. So I have a number of questions I'd like to ask around that announcement and some of the practicalities of it. I wonder if I could start just by trying to understand the policy intent behind this measure. We know that double vaccination, while it helps protect individuals against the symptoms of COVID-19, is not in itself a protection against people either catching the illness or indeed carrying it and passing it on to others. So against that backdrop, I'd like to understand what is the primary reason for the Scottish Government considering this measure. Is it to prevent the spread of COVID-19, or is this more about pushing those who are presently resistant to vaccination, particularly younger people, down the route of taking up vaccinations?
Convener, the primary purpose of the policy proposal that was set out yesterday by the First Minister is to try to strengthen the resistance to the virus by maximising compliance with the measures that we know will have the greatest impact in trying to stem the prevalence of serious illness as a consequence of people contracting the virus. Now, we face a very difficult situation just now because, as members will be familiar, the number of cases has risen very sharply in recent weeks since the relaxation of restrictions on the 9th of August. We've seen a period earlier in the summer where we had a very sharp rise in infections and then a very sharp fall in those infections. What the government is concerned about at this stage is that the rise in infections needs to be tackled with measures to try to reduce its significance because, again, as the First Minister said out to Parliament yesterday, even if 2 to 3% of individuals who are testing positive for COVID have to be admitted to hospital, 2 to 3% of a very large number is a lot of people, and it equates to the levels of hospitalisation at previous stages in the pandemic, which we wish to avoid. So we are trying to take steps within the measures that are available to us, out with the scope to reintroduce restrictions to maximise the capacity of the population to resist the spread of coronavirus. So the purpose of the move is to maximise resistance within the population and to reduce the danger that we have to impose any further restrictions in the future, which the government is clearly very keen to make sure is not the case.
Convener, I'm grateful to Mr. Swinney for that answer. I'm not sure it entirely addressed the question that I asked, though, which was more about which of these two purposes was the primary intention behind the new initiative that's been introduced. But I've had a number of other issues raised with me by constituents. Perhaps I could raise another couple of issues. Clearly, there are concerns around the civil liberties angle of introducing vaccine passports. The Scottish Government has said entirely reasonably that those who have medical conditions that would mean they could not be vaccinated would be exempt from this. Is there any intention on the part of the government also to exempt those who might have objections to taking passports, for example, because they might be members of a religious group who have a belief the vaccination is wrong? Would individuals in that category also be treated as exempt?
Obviously, we can give consideration to the issues and questions that have been raised by Murdo Fraser's constituents on that particular point. I think it's important that we try to ensure that we have the widest possible consent and endorsement to the policy measures that we take forward, and that any exemptions that are applied to an approach of this type are properly founded. What I would say, however, is that it's very important to put in place some clear parameters around the proposal that the government has advanced. And this is about the application of a proposal to a certain number, a limited number of events within the country, events that are all entirely voluntary for individuals to wish to participate in. There is absolutely no question that the government would apply any such approach to accessing public services or other services that are based on entitlement, because that would of itself raise very significant and additional civil liberties questions. But we will certainly give consideration to the issues that are raised by Murdo Fraser and by other members as we formulate the specific nature of the proposal that Parliament will consider.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Just, Convener, if I may, one more issue again on the question of COVID vaccinations, and again going back to some of the correspondence I've had from constituents on this issue. And this really is around the question of the practical implementation of these measures. So we know from what was announced yesterday that outdoor events with an attendance of more than 10,000 will require vaccine certification. So you can see, for example, football matches or rugby matches, 50,000 people turning up at Murrayfield or Hampden or Ibrox or Parkhead would therefore, as I understand it, be required to have proof of vaccination. From a practical point of view, how would you expect that to be addressed? Because that would require the authorities at these stadia, therefore, to employ stewards to check people as they arrive. Presumably, they'd have to have the the technology to be able to do that. There would be training implications. There would be cost implications, issues around the supply of the technology. Has the Scottish Government given thought to how that might be dealt with, and also what timescale you are looking at for the introduction of these measures, given that all these other issues have to be considered?
The timescale that we're looking at for this proposition is for it to be implemented around the end of September. The technology that would underpin this would be utilisation of a QR code, which is a fairly now a reasonably routine aspect of the way in which individuals interact with some aspects of purchasing and ticketing of events. And I think all of the circumstances, you know, large football or rugby games, for example, there will already be ticketing arrangements in place and ticketing checks that will be undertaken at any of these particular events that will be in place. But of course, I've seen commentary overnight from some of the football authorities on this question, and we will of course engage constructively with them about the practical issues that need to be considered in taking forward a policy of this type. I would stress, however, as I said in my opening remarks, that this is a proposal which, given the nature of the proposal, will be the subject of a parliamentary vote, and parliamentary approval will be required.
Thank you.
Thank you. Alex Rowley.
Thank you and good morning. I thought, Deputy First Minister, you were quite clear in saying that this is about maximising compliance, but what evidence do you have? What are you actually basing this on, that by introducing these passports for nightclubs, and I think probably about four football clubs, unfortunately Mon Football Club, Kelty Hearts, won't have that requirement. So you're really talking about perhaps four football clubs in Scotland. Where's the evidence to show that this is going to maximise compliance with vaccination? What is it based on? What is the science? What are the numbers? Not every young person under 30 goes to nightclubs. The majority in Scotland probably don't. So if this is aimed at increasing and maximising compliance with vaccination, where's the evidence for it?
I would say to Mr. Rowley, in the question of Kelty Hearts, he should never say never in relation to the crowds that may appear there. In relation to the evidence base, the government has looked at the wider issues around participation in events, and has considered. And you know, I would accept that there are, on all of these questions, there will be different opinions, and there are contested opinions on these questions. We've looked at that information in the round to satisfy ourselves that to provide us with some greater levels of participation in the vaccination programme, and to further incentivise the individuals to take up vaccination, particularly amongst younger groups, this is an approach which has the potential to provide us with some greater uptake as a consequence of taking this step. And what we have to balance that against is the likelihood that unless we take action to further improve vaccination levels, we may find ourselves having to take action at a later stage, which could potentially lead to the application of further restrictions. And the government is keen to enlist the support and the participation of members of the public in helping us to avoid getting to that position. So we are, we've looked at the balance of evidence on this question and come to the conclusion that this would be an effective way of trying to essentially strengthen that population-wide resistance to the virus by maximising the uptake of vaccination.
You'd be able to provide to the committee the evidence upon which this is based, what you're making this decision based on for these perhaps four football clubs, nightclubs, and will you be able to provide to the committee, as well as that, the other options and the evidence that you've looked at for the other options? I understand why you would want to maximise compliance with vaccine take-up, but I think here in this committee and for next week, we need to know exactly what this is based on, what you're hoping to achieve from it, and what other options you have looked at.
Well, I'm very happy to provide the committee with the range of measures that we have taken to strengthen the vaccination programme. I think it's a pretty established part of the dialogue around about the suppression of COVID that vaccination is a critical, absolutely fundamental element of our strategy. And I think if we look at where we are today with the level of cases that we have in this current period, if we had had anything approaching even a proportion of these cases at a prior stage in the pandemic, well, we know what we would have been doing. We would have been applying lockdown measures. We had to do that in January when we had case levels much lower than the current levels that we have, but we didn't have the protection of the vaccination programme. So vaccination is absolutely central to the response of the government to the pandemic. Now, so I'm very happy to marshal that evidence and to set out to the committee the steps the government has taken to get to the really high levels of vaccination, the extraordinarily high levels of vaccination that we have in the country just now. We do, however, have some challenges in uptake in lower age groups. The over 40s uptake is really extraordinarily high. We've still got some way to go in the 18 to 40 year age group, so we are trying to take steps to maximise the vaccination levels. That is the clear strategy that we're trying to take, because that, by that approach, we take steps to try to avoid having to apply any further restrictions at a later stage. So I'm happy to marshal that information and evidence for the committee. Obviously, we have a parliamentary debate on the wider question, specific question about vaccine certification, which Parliament will consider next week, and the government will make available the necessary information to Parliament to enable Parliament to make an informed decision on that question.
I think that's, I mean, I understand and absolutely praise everyone involved in the vaccination, the rollout of the vaccination. But I think what you've said this morning, Deputy First Minister, is that we have a problem in terms of compliance with the under 40s, and that you're bringing forward this step to try and increase the number of the under 40s getting vaccination. And what I'm saying is, before next week, you need to show us the evidence as to why the specific measures you're talking about have been chosen, what you believe will be achieved for that, and what other options have been considered for increasing uptake in the under 40s. I support absolutely the vaccination and will support taking action to increase the vaccination, but we need to see what evidence that's based on. But finally, can I ask, in terms of compliance, we seem to have a relaxation in some areas, particularly in shops, of people wearing face coverings. And if you're going to introduce new measures, I think you should equally be looking at ensuring that the measures that are in place are being enforced. I certainly this week have talked to shop workers who work for different chains of shops, and they tell me that in some shops, that particularly again in younger people, but it's grown, that people are simply not complying with wearing face coverings, and therefore what action Can the government take working with retailers to look at what is becoming an increasing problem of people simply not complying with wearing face coverings?
I agree 100% with Mr. Rowley's point in relation to compliance with what I would describe as baseline measures. And baseline measures include the wearing of face coverings in indoor settings where the regulations specify that should be the case. And no retail employee or any transport employee around the country should get any stick from a member of the public about the being called upon to wear a face covering, because that's what the law requires individuals to do. Now, in relation to the action that we've taken in this respect, I want to reassure Mr. Rowley that the Cabinet is actively engaged in supporting different sectors in ensuring there is the effective application of the baseline measures. And there are three steps that I would particularly highlight to the committee this morning. The first is that for the best part of the last 10 days, members of the Cabinet and our officials have been in regular discussion with all of the sectoral contacts that we have to encourage and support them in ensuring that they apply the baseline measures that are necessary in this respect. And indeed, yesterday, Professor Leach and myself, the Chief Medical Officer, and a number of members of the Cabinet met with over 150 representatives of different sectors of our society, from the operators of some of our transport companies to the figures within the retail industry, to other business organisations, representatives of trade unions and the workforce, to basically reinforce the necessity of the application of the baseline measures. So there has been very, very active dialogue by members of the Cabinet and our officials with all sectors to try to achieve the objectives that Mr. Rowley correctly highlights as being important. The second area is that we have obviously used our public messaging as a government to make sure that the application of the baseline measures is clearly understood by members of the public, and we have used countless opportunities to try to do that and to reinforce that message. And thirdly, the government's the public information communications campaigns are being adapted to reinforce the message that Mr. Rowley talks about, because if we don't have a greater application of the baseline measures, then we will not be able to see the intervention that is required to suppress the increasing levels of the virus that we are seeing. And if we don't interrupt those increasing levels, then it will naturally flow that we will have more admissions to hospital. And if we have more admissions to hospital, then we will have greater pressure on the National Health Service. Clearly, we are trying to avoid that and to sustain the recovery in the National Health Service that is currently underway. So I'm wholeheartedly in agreement with Mr. Rowley about the importance of members of the public acknowledging and realising that by applying the baseline measures, we can all play our part in suppressing the rise of COVID within our community. And although it is not generating the degree of serious illness that it was at a previous stage, it does still have the capacity to undermine the sustainability of the National Health Service.
Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. If I may, can I bring in Professor Jason Leach to address some of the members' concerns regarding evidence based decisions regarding the restrictions?
Well, in general terms, in light of the questions that have been asked, let me make a couple of points, and then I'm happy to take follow-ups, of course. And thank you for having me. It's nice to be back in a slightly refreshed version of the committee, and congratulations, convener. It's nice to be asked to be here. The Deputy First Minister has covered it very well, in fact. Requests for neat evidence are always slightly challenging because this pandemic is not as neat and as linear as we would perhaps like. Let me make a couple of points initially. Vaccinated individuals are safer than unvaccinated individuals. They do actually stop transmission. They don't stop it entirely, but they are less likely to transmit. Now, Delta has made that equation a little bit difficult. Mr. Fraser is absolutely right. And Delta, the transmission reduction is less than it was with the previous versions of the virus, but you are still less likely to transmit and you're less likely to catch and you're definitely less likely to be seriously unwell. But it's just not as dramatic as it was with the previous version. So vaccinated individuals are safer in themselves, but they're also safer in crowds. So vaccinated crowds are safer than unvaccinated crowds, for sure. The third thing about vaccination that we're only just learning, big study yesterday, is you're 50% less likely to get long COVID. 50% less likely to get long COVID. That's a massive gain from vaccination and another reason, if we needed one, to add to the vaccination incentives, the vaccination programme. To Mr. Rowley, I would say the things you mentioned, Mr. Rowley, are not mutually exclusive. We're not suggesting vaccine certification replaces anything else, or if you put screens back in supermarkets, you don't need COVID certification. We're suggesting these are layers of protection against a vicious infectious disease that is still killing tens of thousands a day across the world, that you need to double down on everything you're doing. And the meeting we had yesterday with football, with retail, with sport, with entertainment, with the whole of the country was all about get everybody vaccinated, get everybody tested twice a week and follow the guidance. In fact, go beyond the guidance if you possibly can. The vaccination certificate is for both of Mr. Fraser's reasons that he said at the beginning. It is, of course, to incentivise those who are unvaccinated and it is to protect those areas where the unvaccinated will go, because it is safer to go to vaccinated crowds. There isn't any doubt about that. Now, it's not my job to decide if that's something Scotland wants to do. That's Mr. Swinney and the Parliament's job. My job is to provide the advice that says vaccinated crowds are safer.
Thank you, Professor Leitch. Jim Fairley, would you like to ask a question?
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much to the panel for attending this morning. I've got two or three areas that I'd like, or questions I'd like to cover. They might be a wee bit jumbled up, but please bear with me. I absolutely agree with what Mr. Rowley has just said about compliance. In my hotel dining room this morning, over half the people who were there weren't wearing face masks. So there is possibly an issue about the fact that we still have face mask control in Scotland and they don't have it in other parts of the country. So people coming into the country really need to know what the regulations are in this country. We had a young people's panel here last week and we asked the question of them, do you feel that the restrictions have been done to you or are you complying with them because you are part of the process? And they very much came back with the belief that it was being done to them. The COVID, the vaccine passports will feel again like it is being done to people. And that goes back to the messaging that Mr. Swinney spoke about. Could there be, while we are putting the COVID vaccine passports in place, could there not be something far more visible, vibrant and stronger in the messaging that we're getting out of how important getting this vaccine is to that specific demographic?
I think it's important that we constantly revisit the messaging that we have on the whole issue of COVID to make sure that it's achieving its purpose. I think in general, government communications over the course of the pandemic have been very effective and very focused in getting that message across. I think particularly for younger people, we have to make sure there is good, strong evidence that is available to them about the dangers that to which they are exposed as a consequence of COVID. The committee has discussed, Parliament has discussed extensively the whole question of long COVID. Long COVID for younger people could be a very, very serious factor in their lives. So I think the most important thing is that we have got to make sure that we properly and fully address the issues and the perspectives of young people in identifying how most effectively we can communicate a message of this type and ensure that it is persuasive to young people that they are as much at risk from COVID as other members of our society. And I think it's important that we don't have a message that suggests anything other than the fact that young people face some significant risks as a consequence of this virus.
Okay, I just point out that when you're young, you think you're invincible, so we need to get over that mental block in the first place. The requirement for the vaccine passports, I'd first of all like to ask, is there likely to be any extension to the areas that we're currently talking about doing? And perhaps the second bit is more directed to Mr. Leach. We now know that the virus is in the community. We know that what Mr. Swinney has just said, that what we're trying to do is to suppress it with the range of measures that we have in place. Are we accepting that this is now a present disease that will be with us? And are we trying to create community immunity while we manage it to the next stage?
I think if I could address that latter point from Mr. Fairley is an important one, because it gets to the heart of a point that I made in my opening statement, that the government has changed its approach to the handling of the pandemic. And what I said earlier on is that we are no longer seeking to suppress COVID to the lowest possible level. Now that we have vaccinations, the restrictions required to suppress COVID could not be justified, given that those restrictions cause serious harms of their own. So what we are trying to do is to operate within a context where we have vaccination available to us, and if we maximise the uptake of vaccination, we provide the greatest amount of protection against the prevalence of the virus. Now, if we go back to, I think the best way to explain this is to go back to the situation we faced in January. In January, the government got advice which basically said to us that unless we applied a further immediate lockdown, there would be very serious risk, if not inevitability, that our health service would be unable to meet its central purpose and commitment to members of the public. Now, we had to follow that advice because we had such a low level of the population vaccinated at that time. It was a tiny proportion of the population were vaccinated, and even then it was only with one dose of the vaccine in a very limited number of people in our society. Here today, we find ourselves in a very different situation with a very, very successful vaccination programme in the over 40s, but a vaccination programme in the under 40s that has still got some way to go. And we are trying to take steps to enable us to essentially maximise the protection we can achieve from the vaccination programme. So that is the strategy the government is pursuing. We are trying to utilise vaccination as the means of resisting the pressure the virus can put on us, and to avoid having to take any further restrictive measures, because we know that, and we know this from the four harms analysis that the previous committee questioned me about before the election in May, which dominated our thinking and planning as we moved as we took steps to relax restrictions over the course of the last 12 months or so, that we had to take steps that would make that would adapt and change given the presence and the of the vaccination programme within our society and its effectiveness. So there has been a change in the way the government is handling these issues, and it is to recognise the fact that COVID creates multiple harms, and we have to avoid those multiple harms, and the best way to do that is by having very high participation in the vaccination programme and by following the baseline measures that I discussed earlier with Mr. Rowley. Mr. Fairley also asked if there would be any plans to change or extend the certification beyond the very limited number of groupings that we highlighted before, and the government has no plans to do that. I don't know if Professor Leach wants to add to anything that I said.
A couple of things, if I might, DFM. Mr. Fairley, your point about youth comms, if I might summarise it like that, is a good one. And I make it often to my marketing colleagues, because I'm very involved in the communications, and their answer is a lot of that is invisible to 52-year-olds. And when they show me it, it is stuff I've never seen, because it is in mediums that I don't use, that I would imagine you don't use either. I might be wrong. But we have enormous advertising campaigns on podcasts, on TikTok, in schools, in all the places you would expect it to be, using different voices from the 52-year-old guy's voice. I've also spent a lot of time in the last few weeks with Young Scots. They have a health panel. I talk to the health panel then talk to the young people. So there are all kinds of mechanisms in there with education, with the NUS, with Young Scot to get that messaging out. It is hard, and they get bombarded with information that isn't from trusted sources, and we have to compete against that a little. And anything that MSPs can do in their environment to help us with that messaging is, of course, appreciated. But much of the youth comms is invisible to the 50-year-olds because it's elsewhere. Your second question about endemic infection, it has been answered by DFM in a political sense, in what we're headed to. In a scientific sense, you're kind of right that we are moving from a pandemic infection to an endemic infection. But I would just remind everybody that 750,000 people caught this virus yesterday. 750,000. So what Scotland does is only part of that puzzle for the global pandemic. We are a long way from done. 24,000 people died yesterday around the world of COVID. And that's a big underestimate, because there's not testing everywhere. There isn't registration everywhere. So the pandemic will continue for some time until we can vaccinate our way out of it. In Scotland, we are moving gradually to making this infection an endemic infection, an infection we will live with. But that's a very gradual process, and one that we have to do very, very cautiously, because there is still harm in an endemic virus. There is still hospital pressure in an endemic virus. And we're not quite sure, because we can't be sure, what that looks like in the medium to long term. But you can see the change in immunity helping us out of that. In immunity, principally vaccination immunity, but also some previous disease immunity, people who have had the disease and or not then vaccinated. That helps us get out of it. So that is absolutely the route out, but it also takes us to having to protect ourselves from other variants. Delta will not be the last variant globally. So we have to think very carefully what Scotland does and what the rest of the world does.
Thank you very much for that. One very final quick question, and this is specifically answering constituency requests that we've had overnight. I think everybody in the panel has talked about the flood of emails we all had last night. And that is, will this passport, I can almost answer it myself, will this passport be time limited?
In what respect?
In the respect of, will it be time limited in the sense that once we start carrying, if we're accepting the fact that we have an endemic disease within our community, will the passports then be required forever, is the terminology I'm getting in my emails.
Well, that it really depends on the course of the pandemic and the degree to which that becomes less of a present and prevalent threat to us. You know, the government's not doing this because it just decided to do this. It's doing this because we are looking at what steps we have to take to protect the population and specifically to try to avoid having to apply any further restrictions on the population. We want to avoid that if we possibly can do. So this we consider to be another step to try to help us to avoid having to take a step of that nature.
Thank you. I'm just conscious of time. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Gavina, and good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for coming to give us evidence. I've got a couple of issues I wanted to raise. One with vaccine passports. I think we all recognise the sort of moving feast that tackling this pandemic is, and that ideas and change as we're going along. And I think, you know, it's not a criticism at all, Mr. Swinney, that not that long ago vaccine passports were ruled out. And as evidence obviously has come forward, the government has decided that they should be ruled in. But on the backdrop of that, speaking with the music industry, nightclubs and sport industry, they feel that they have not been consulted as these decisions have been made. And I think that for me, and the understanding that the business's responsibility to practically implement this policy. So there's a couple of things. One, how do you envisage that being policed? And secondly, how does the Scottish Government consult with the industries prior to making these decisions? Because surely it is much better to have their input into a decision-making process rather than, as my colleague Jim Fairley suggested to the younger people, have those issues imposed upon the industry. How is the consultation process done?
I think the first point I want to agree with Mr. Whittle about is on the question of the description of COVID as a moving feast. Because, you know, we are facing a constantly moving challenge on this, and the government has got to be prepared, I think, if we're going to be realistic about addressing the implications of COVID, to adapt and change our position should we need to do so. And that is precisely the approach the government has taken throughout the pandemic. We've not sat and been oblivious to changing circumstances or changing prevalence of the virus. If we'd done that, then I think we would have had a much more serious situation on our hands than the very serious situation that we have already faced. So the government has to adapt to changing circumstances, and that is exactly what we've done here. We do try to discuss issues with business sectors on an ongoing basis. We have a huge amount of dialogue goes on with all sectors of society, and we do take on board the practical feedback that we get from sectors. But ultimately, government has to make choices, and sometimes it's difficult to make choices in a fashion that that involves as much open prior dialogue and consultation than we would ordinarily like. Yesterday, Mr. Fraser, and I understand exactly why he was saying this, raised a point of order with the presiding officer that prior to the First Minister standing up, there was some media commentary about the COVID certification issue. And I think the time difference between the First Minister standing up and that point appearing in the media was maybe 20 to 30 minutes. If the government had open consultation with sectors beforehand, then I think it's pretty clear that information would have been out before Parliament heard it. And Parliament, understandably, would have been pretty aggrieved about that. Now, what I said in my response to earlier questions is that the government will, of course, engage with sectors to make sure we hear all these questions before Parliament is it comes to conclusions on these points. And I give that assurance to Mr Whittock today. It is important we have that dialogue. I had a very constructive discussion with, as I said, over 150 sectoral representatives yesterday about the importance of applying the baseline measures. And I detected amongst all those organisations a willingness to be part of this journey with us. And if we're all part of that journey, then we can get to a good and positive outcome.
Thank you, Mr. Swinney. Just a very quick follow-up to that question before I move on to my next point. I think one of the things that have come into my inbox just this morning was the question of how do you define a nightclub? For example, and I think again, this is where consultation I think is so important, because on one side of the street you can have what is designated as a nightclub with 250 people in it, and across the street we can have a pub with 250 people in it, you know, blasting out loud music. One needs passport vaccination and the other doesn't. So I think again, it's how do we make sure that consultation is done and that everybody feels that they're being treated fairly.
I think that's a very material point, and it's a point that was raised with me yesterday by some of the sectoral representatives, that there can be a pretty fine line between different venues, and we'll discuss those issues with the relevant sectors. As I say, we want to avoid, First Minister made this clear yesterday, we do not want to apply this to the hospitality sector as a whole, so we want to avoid avoid any steps that might take us into that territory. So the point of distinction that Mr Whittock raises is an important point for us to get right in the judgments that we make.
Thank you. If I can move on to another topic that's been raised with me again just this morning, and it is the implications of specific sectors that have to isolate awaiting COVID tests, and the ones that were raised with this morning was nurseries having to close while they wait for COVID tests, and of course the knock-on effect on business, the business world, and our economic recovery, schools where a significant amount of teachers are missing in schools, and how do we recover bringing schools back to full learning capacity with increased shortage of teachers? And of course that also applies to an NHS where I know that there are significant shortages across a lot of disciplines because people are absent waiting COVID test results. So how do we tackle and recover the backlog in an NHS with these increased shortages? I think that is obviously a circle that's incredibly difficult to square, but how is the Scottish Government looking at that particular issue as we recover from this, hopefully recover from this virus?
This is a critical issue, and the government has of course changed the regulatory environment around self-isolation in recent period, and specifically as to how that relates to an educational context. The reason for doing that has been based on a risk assessment of the effectiveness, or the necessity, I should say, of self-isolation in the context of a more highly vaccinated at-risk population. So we have less onerous self-isolation requirements today than we had at previous stages at the pandemic. We justify that because we have higher levels of vaccination within the population. But having said all of that, I acknowledge the point that Mr Whittock fairly makes, that if there are a number of cases in a school or an early learning centre, then that is clearly disruptive to a range of children and young people, and we are trying to minimise the disruption to their education. But obviously, if they are required to self-isolate, it will have knock-on effects in at home and amongst people who ordinarily might expect to be at their employment. So it is a very difficult circle to square, and we believe we have taken pragmatic and risk-assessed judgments about the approach to self-isolation, but it does not insulate us entirely from the impact of the virus. What will insulate us entirely is by having compliance with the baseline measures, reducing our contact, and seeing a fall in the number of cases. It's the high number of cases that's the problem in driving this process, not, I believe, the requirements on self-isolation. They're a consequence of the high number of cases. So if we concentrate on the steps to try to reduce the number of cases, and by application of the baseline measures and other factors such as vaccination, then we can contribute significantly to trying to address this issue. I don't know if Professor Leach wants to add to that in relation to the self-isolation requirements.
Only contextually, DFM, Mr. Whittle, let's remember how big a change this was in terms of risk. And remember, nothing is safe. Safety is a relative concept, not an absolute concept. So whatever we do here is risk. So we made a massive piece of advice, and the government made a very big decision to change the self-isolation rules for adults and children from 10 days for close contact, reduced down to wait for a negative PCR and then release. That's a huge change in terms of risk. And we've not long done that. Relatively recent change. We were under huge pressure from industry, from education, from parents, from kids, because they were isolating and not that many of them were converting into positive cases. We now know in some sectors that was about 5% of people were converting from contact to positive case. So that's all about a big risk judgment. So we decided, unlike some other countries, there are countries who are freer in that sense, and there are countries that are tighter in that sense. We made the choice in our advice to say, we think it's now time in the pandemic, because of the list of things Mr. Swinney mentioned, principally vaccination, that we would now move to a more risky version of that by allowing people to isolate until they get a negative test, then they would be released. There is a specific nuance in health and care where we believe it is more risky than other settings because of the nature of the job, where if that contact is a household contact, you still have to isolate for the 10 days. And that is causing some challenges to health and care workforce, of course. And it's a balance between the risk of sending those people back to work and a risk of sending those people back to work with or without COVID. So each of those equations is really challenging, but we've made a big change. I think the correct change for this point in the pandemic, and eventually coming out the other end of this, will make it even more relaxed, but not yet.
Thank you. Can I call John Mason?
Thanks so much, convener. And I think I've got three questions I want to ask. Continuing on the question of vaccination certificates, I suppose they depend on how robust the underlying information is within the NHS system. And so my question is, how robust is that information? I have constituents contacting me who had one JAG in Scotland and one perhaps in England or Germany or some other country, so they've got a problem. And I myself had both my JAGs in Easter House in Glasgow, but the NHS system says I only had one JAG, so I cannot get a certificate. And the NHS in Glasgow said that that is a national problem, not just a local problem. So how robust are our records?
Obviously, over 4 million people have been vaccinated within Scotland. So I would be confident that for the overwhelming majority of those individuals, vaccine records will be strong and robust. I think I would have to accept, because of what John Mason has just put to me, there will be instances where there are issues with the accuracy of the information. any suspected errors in a person's COVID vaccination record should be reported to the National Helpline. There's a telephone number available for that, and the information is contained on the NHS Inform website. But in general, the quality and the strength of health records in Scotland are very strong, fundamentally because they are anchored in the CHI number that every citizen has, and that provides us with a very robust footing and foundation for the delivery of information about vaccination records for individuals. But I would have to accept that there will be limited cases where that information may not be entirely complete.
Okay, thanks so much for that. I shall continue phoning the number, as I have been. Another one, still on vaccination, I suppose, is I have a bit of a moral dilemma as to whether I should take a third or booster vaccine when half the people around the world haven't had any vaccines. I mean, that does strike me as being a bit greedy on my part. So where are we with boosters, and should we be holding back a bit so that the rest of the world can get some?
I think there's a moral and an ethical dilemma that in all of that that I suspect could keep us here for a long, long time debating the contents of that particular issue. We expect to receive advice fairly soon from the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation in relation to booster JAGs. We will be ready to implement a programme of deployment of those booster vaccinations when such a strategic decision is given to us by the Joint Committee on Vaccination and Immunisation. As the committee will be aware, we have, as our predecessors have done, followed the JCVI advice on all questions in relation to vaccination, and essentially you know, we await that advice to come in relation to booster JAGs. I think there is a moral dilemma here. We obviously take part in discussions with the United Kingdom government, who take part in the international discussions about the necessity of ensuring fair and equitable access to vaccination around the globe, because as Jason Leach indicated in the data earlier on in one of his answers, this remains a significant global problem, and until such time as we have effective vaccination around the world, we will still face significant and acute threats as a consequence of COVID.
Hey, thanks also for that answer. And my third and final point, on a completely different subject, is we've had the kind of suggestion from the airline and I think the wider tourism industry that they are hoping to go back to the same level that they were at pre-pandemic. But we also have a COP coming up and we have climate change concerns. So, I mean, is it the government's feeling that we should be aiming to get the airline industry back to 100% of where it was? I think they're currently at 20 or 25%. Or should we be aiming at something in between for the benefit of climate change?
What we've got to make sure in the immediate term is that we take the steps that are necessary to be taken in relation to international travel that are appropriate to tackle COVID. Now, these issues have been the subject of great controversy, and I read lots of commentary from people telling us that we have been far too restrictive on international travel. At different stages in the pandemic, I don't think the United Kingdom was strict enough. But you know, these are difficult issues to wrestle with. The whole question of the scale and the nature of air travel and the environmental issues that come with air travel will be something that we have to address as part of the measures to tackle climate change. And that will be, it's a wider policy process in which government is involved. It will be at the heart of the discussions around COP later on this year in Glasgow. And all societies will have to wrestle with this question. But the immediate challenge we have to face is to make sure we have the correct approach on international travel that is commensurate with the steps that we need to take to suppress COVID as effectively as we can within the population.
Thank you.
Yes, can I bring in Alex Rowley?
Specifically on that, Mr. Swinney, the industry itself has raised a number of concerns, but one of the concerns is that for those people who require to be tested, they say there's a monopoly over the tests, and due to that, it's far more expensive for people to have to access the test. I wonder if that's something you've heard of and it's something that you've looked at.
It is an issue with which I am familiar. There are there have been many discussions about this particular point. Much of this is driven by the systems of which we are a part to operating on a UK-wide basis, but I think there is there is some flexibility being assessed as part of addressing the concerns that have been raised by the airline industry.
Thank you. I appreciate we're running slightly over, but I was going to hopefully have two more short questions. If I may just ask, in the previous season, I understand that the Scottish Government routinely provided the COVID-19 committee with draft regulation for consideration before they were made into law. Do you still envisage that the committee will be provided with the draft health protection regulations on the Wednesday by 4 p.m. ahead of our meetings on Thursday morning?
I would expect that to be the case, convener, although we are in a period where I would hope we don't have to be in a position of applying any further restrictions. So the necessity of coming to the committee for regulatory change of that type, I hope, is something that we do less of in the future. But I certainly would want to maintain the protocols that have been in place before. And I don't know if Dominic Munro wants to, who's online with me, as to whether he wants to add anything to that to that answer.
I don't think I need to add too much, DFM. I hope you can hear me okay. I would just say two things, and I've got a colleague who's, I think, joining the panel later, who covers our legal issues, who might be able to follow up on this, Liz Blair. But the point is that with all our restrictions, and particularly those that are regulations, we are required by law to keep them under regular review. So although, as DFM says, the intention is not to bring, if you like, new regulations back regularly to this committee, because we're trying not to impose new restrictions, for those regulations that remain in place, it is our intention to keep them under regular review to make sure that they're proportionate and necessary and justified, which is what we're required to do under the current legislation. Thank you.
Thank you. For the final question, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. I just have one follow-up question going back to the issue of vaccine passports. John Mason in his question mentioned COP26 that's coming up in Glasgow in November. I'm assuming, therefore, that under the plans being announced by the Scottish Government, everyone attending COP26 will have to provide proof of double vaccination. Is that the case?
There are discussions underway with the United Kingdom Government and the United Nations around the arrangements in respect for accessing COP26. So many of these issues are the subject of active discussion with the authorities who are running COP26 to ensure that we have the appropriate arrangements in place.
Thank you. And that concludes our consideration for agenda item number one. We move on to agenda item number two. We shall now move on to take evidence on the latest ministerial statement on COVID-19, two monthly reports and subordinate legislation. I welcome Elizabeth Blair, team leader, COVID coordination, governance and decision making, who will be joining the Deputy First Minister in this agenda item. The committee will consider regulations that were laid over the summer. The full list of SSIs are in the agenda, but to summarise this, we will consider number 27 to number 32, amendments to the health protection, coronavirus restrictions and requirements, local level Scotland regulations, the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements, Scotland Regulations 2021, SSI 2021/277, the Coronavirus Scotland Act 2020, Early Expiry of Provisions, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021/214, the Coronavirus Scotland Act 2020, Early Expiry of Provisions, Number 2, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021/236. The Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Act 2021, Evidence Saving Provision, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021/280, and the Coronavirus Act 2020, Suspension Disposal of Bodies, Scotland Regulations 2021, SSI 2021/250. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move to questions?
Thank you, Convener. If I could perhaps make some remarks in relation to the number of SSIs that are on today's agenda. Six of these SSIs amended the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions and Requirements Local Levels Scotland Regulations 2020. These made various adjustments to the levels rules which were in place at the time and have since been removed when we moved beyond level zero on the 9th of August. In order to assist the committee, I will run through the changes made by these regulations. The number 27 amendment regulations, which came into force on the 11th of June, made provision for local authority officers to have a power of entry in relation to restrictions on stadia and events. These regulations also adjusted the physical distancing requirements in place at Hampden and Glasgow Green during the Euros. The number 28 amendment regulations removed travel restrictions in relation to the Republic of Ireland and Bedford in England, and introduced travel restrictions in relation to travel to and from Manchester and Salford. These regulations came into force on the 18th of June. The number 29 amendment regulations came into force on the 26th and 28th of June and made a number of changes, including adjusting physical distancing requirements at funerals and for an event at Murrayfield, extending hospitality opening hours for the knockout stages of the Euros, adjusting the face covering rules at weddings and civil partnerships. The number 30 amendment regulations removed all travel restrictions in relation to Bolton, Manchester and Salford on the 30th of June. The number 31 amendment regulations adjusted the physical distancing requirements at the Scottish Open and removed travel restrictions in relation to Blackburn and Darwin. These regulations came into force on the 8th of July. The number 32 amendment regulations came into force on the 19th of July. These regulations moved all of Scotland into level zero and made various adjustments to the levels regulations. Physical distancing requirements were reduced to 1 metre indoors and outdoors. The regulations also removed the requirement for physical distancing between people in a gathering of up to 15 outdoors. They also provided that children under the age of 12 years did not count for the purpose of calculating the number of households permitted for gatherings indoors. And the regulations also altered hospitality trading times at level zero. As you know, we were able to move beyond level zero on the 9th of August. At that point, baseline measures were put in place in the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Regulations 2021. These regulations set out four sets of legal requirements as baseline measures. First, relevant hospitality and entertainment premises are required to obtain and record customer information for a period of at least 21 days for the purpose of preventing the spread of coronavirus or monitoring the spread of infection and the incidence of coronavirus disease. Second, the regulations require persons responsible for places of worship carrying on a business or providing a service to have regard to relevant guidance by the Scottish ministers and available on the Scottish Government website about measures to minimise risk of exposure to coronavirus. Third, the regulations also provide that people in specified indoor places and on public transport must wear a face covering unless a specific exemption applies. And finally, the regulations cap numbers at live events at 5,000 people for events held outdoors and at 2,000 people for events held indoors, subject to local authority approval of higher attendance limits. Scottish ministers are also provided with powers to call in applications for exemption from capacity. These new regulations, like the previous levels regulations, provide for the enforcement of the requirements, and the regulations provide that they must be reviewed at least once every 21 days. Scottish ministers are required to revoke any requirement as soon as it is no longer necessary. The first review had to take place by the 30th of August. Those regulations remain in force, but we are keeping the requirements under review. Finally, Convener, I would like to inform the committee that the Scottish Government's report on the Coronavirus Extension and Expiry Scotland Act 2021 will be laid before Parliament tomorrow. This report fulfils the requirement in sections 5 and 7 of that Act to lay a one-off report before the Scottish Parliament 1 month after the Act received royal assent. I am very happy to answer any questions the committee may have about the regulation.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I now turn to questions. If I may begin by asking first question, can I seek clarification whether the committee will be given secondary legislation to consider the policy on vaccine passports, or whether this will just be a motion taken or as part of a chamber debate, and if subordinate legislation will be forthcoming, in what timescale, and what will be subject to the affirmative procedure rather than the emergency made affirmative procedure?
The committee may well have to consider SSIs on this question. Obviously, the nature of the parliamentary debate is to seek parliamentary approval in principle behind the concept of the approach the government is taking, recognising the very different and distinctive character of the decision. But any other requirements for legislative provision or for enforcement will require to come to the committee and to the Delegated Powers Committee, and the government will fulfil all requirements in that respect. As to the question of whether the emergency procedure will be required to be undertaken is a question I can't answer today, but I will answer when we have come to conclusions on that point and will advise the committee of our conclusion.
Thank you. I'll open up questions from other members. Odo Fraser.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I really just have a question on one of the instruments before us, which is the SSI 2021/277, which is an instrument that requires, subject to some exemptions, face covering should still be worn in some indoor spaces. Now, this was the subject of some discussion in the Parliament's Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee on Tuesday this week, and they identified that the guidance states that face coverings are not required to be worn while dancing in a nightclub or dance hall. However, there is no specific exemption for dancing listed in the instrument. So I just wanted to ask for some clarity around that particular issue and whether this has been an omission from the terms of the instrument.
I will have to look in detail at the point that Mr. Fraser has raised, but Elizabeth Blair may want to add to the response on this particular question. But the regulations will have been framed in a fashion to try to provide the greatest degree of clarity and certainty in these circumstances. So the policy purpose will have been, the intention will have been to draft on that basis. But Elizabeth may wish to add to my comments there.
Yes, thank you, Deputy First Minister. The regulations provide an exemption to the face covering requirements where a person is exercising, and that is the basis on which the face covering requirement when a person is dancing is not required.
Right, thank you. Thank you for that answer. I suppose the issue then becomes when is dancing not dancing? Maybe that's the question for Michael Gove rather than yourself, Deputy First Minister. But I suppose if there's an exemption for people exercising, does that apply to people walking, for example? Or what constitutes exercise?
Well, I think the difference and the distinction there would be that there is a greater degree of physical participation beyond what one would consider to be routine elements of everyday human functions, such as walking. which I think would be the distinction that would be made there.
Okay, thank you. Well, we could, I'm sure, pursue this in great detail, but I think it just highlights the need for a degree of precision in relation to the drafting of these instruments. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. At this stage, can we please bring in Professor Jason Leach?
I would just say exactly the same as Elizabeth said. It's an exercise, common sense exemption. So walking to the bathroom in the nightclub is not exercise, but walking on a treadmill in a gym is. So we're asking people to use their common sense to, and you are exempted from face coverings if you're eating, drinking, or exercising.
Thank you. Has any other members got any questions? That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today.
Thank you.
We now move on to agenda item number 3. I now move to the third agenda item, which is consideration of the motions on the made affirmative instruments considered during the previous agenda item. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on the SSIs before we take the motions?
No, Convener.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Are members content for motions S6M-00695, S6M-00694, S6M-00693, S6M-00692, S6M-00702, S6M-00701, and S6M-009010 to be moved on block. Agree? Thank you. Members are agreed to move the motions on block. I now invite the Deputy First Minister to move en bloc motion S6M-00695- that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee recommends that the health protection, coronavirus restrictions and requirements, local levels, Scotland Amendment No. 27, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021-238 be approved. Motion S6M-00694, that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee recommends that the health protection, coronavirus restrictions and requirements, local levels, Scotland Amendment No. 28, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021-242 be approved. Motion S6M-00693, that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee recommends that the health protection, coronavirus restriction and requirements, local levels, Scotland Amendment No. 29, Regulation 2021, SSI 2021-252 be approved. Motion S6M-00692, that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee recommends that the health protection, coronavirus restrictions and requirements, local levels, Scotland Amendment No. 30, Regulation 2021, SSI 2021-255 be approved. Motion S6M-00702, that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee recommends that the health protection, coronavirus restriction and requirements, local levels, Scotland Amendment No. 31, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021-262 be approved. Motion S6M-00701, that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee recommends that the health protection, coronavirus restrictions and requirements, local levels, Scotland Amendment No. 32, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021-263 be approved. Motion S6M-00901, that the COVID-19 Recovery Committee recommends that the health protection, coronavirus requirements, Scotland's Regulations 2021, SSI 2021-277 be approved. Could I ask the Deputy First Minister to move the motions en bloc?
Moved on, Lord Convener.
Thank you. Is there any comments from members? I know that no member has indicated that they wish to speak, so we'll now put the question on the motions. The question is motions S6M00695, S6M00694, S6M00693, S6M00692, S6M00702, S6M00701, and S6M00901 to be agreed. Do members agree? The motions are agreed to. The committee will publish a report to Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instruments considered at this meeting in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to end our time with the Deputy First Minister, and I would like to thank the Deputy First Minister for his attendance today.
Thank you.
And I suspend this meeting briefly to allow the witnesses to leave the meeting. Moving on to agenda item four, and I now move to the fourth agenda item, which is consideration of the evidence heard earlier in the meeting on three negative instruments, which are the Coronavirus Scotland Act 2020, Early Expiry of Provisions, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021, oblique 214, and the Coronavirus Scotland Act 2020, Early Expiry of Provisions, number 2, Regulations 2021, SSI 2021, oblique 236, and the Coronavirus Extension Expiry Scotland Act 2021, Evidence Saving Provisions, Regulation 2021, SSI 2021, oblique 280. These are negative instruments, which means the Parliament has 40 days to consider a motion to annul them. We have taken evidence on the instruments from the Deputy First Minister this morning, and motions to annul these instruments have not been lodged. Have I got any comments from members? Are members content that this concludes our scrutiny of these negative instruments?
Yes.
Thank you. That concludes our business for this morning. This committee's next meeting will be on the 9th of September, when we will be taking evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero, Energy and Transport on international travel regulations. I now close the meeting. Thank you.